The next type of solid is called network covalent solids. Back in Chapter 5, when students were asked to draw Lewis structures, if you were given the formula SiO2, silicon dioxide, students might come up with four bonds and draw the structure like this, with silicon in the middle and double bonds to each oxygen. Now that you know a little bit about intermolecular forces, we know that carbon dioxide is a gas at room temperature and only has dispersion forces. Silicon is a little bit heavier than carbon, so we might think that perhaps it would be a liquid or possibly still a gas. But in fact, silicon dioxide is another name for sand and is a solid at room temperature. So clearly, dispersion forces do not explain the difference in the state of matter. What does explain the difference is classifying silicon dioxide as a network covalent solid. What holds network covalent solids together? Once again, it is the Coulombic force of the attraction between opposite charges. Here is your silicon dioxide, silicon, oxygen, another silicon. So we have nuclei and shared electrons, which we call covalent bonds. And as you know, covalent bonds are very strong, so network covalent solids will have high melting points. Carbon has many network covalent solids. These are called allotropes. One such network covalent solid is graphite. It's composed of an infinite number of carbons, and you notice this is sort of like a benzene ring, but without the hydrogens. We definitely see there's some resonance. Benzene is planar, and graphite sheets are also planar. Graphite sheets tend to be about 3.4 angstroms apart, and the unhybridized p orbitals are what make these sheets of carbon cling together with weak dispersion forces. Graphite, of course, is used in pencil leads for test taking, and also as a lubricant for some high temperature machinery. 60 carbons together form this unique structure known as buckyball. It sort of looks like a soccer ball with 5-membered rings and 6-membered rings. This was discovered in 1985. This molecule is difficult to manufacture in large quantities, so there are no commercial uses thus far. But scientists have envisioned many uses for buckyball, including trapping free radicals within the body to prevent aging, coatings for solar cells, or even hydrogen storing for hydrogen-powered cars. Another form of carbon is known as the nanotube. This is a sheet of graphite, but rolled into a tube. Nanotubes, depending on which way they are rolled, can act as a conductor or semiconductor, which means you can use them to build small wires, diodes, and transistors. So these can be building parts for very tiny machines. Now, while we don't yet have tiny machines that go and deliver medicine specifically to different cells, graphite rods or filaments have been used in coatings to make extremely wear-resistant paints, like for your skateboard. The nanotube was discovered in 1991, and it is 6 times lighter and 100 times stronger than steel. To give you an idea of how strong it is, take a look at just one of your hairs. If a nanotube had the same thickness as one of your hairs, it would be about 60 inches long and unbendable. Copper wire that thin definitely bends. So you can see how a nanotube is a very unique molecule. What have scientists done with nanotubes and buckyballs so far? Many interesting things, but how about little tiny molecular-sized cars? And yes, several of them actually roll. Another network covalent solid of carbon is diamond. This is the unit cell for carbon atoms in the diamond form. Diamond is, of course, the hardest substance known and a very expensive gift. When I teach this live, I always ask the audience, Which diamond is this? There's always somebody that knows this is the Hope Diamond, which is in the Smithsonian Institute. So that brings us back to silicon dioxide. Sand is one form of silicon dioxide. Another different type of unit cell, but with the same molecular formula, is cristobalite. This is natural high-temperature glass. And here's a picture where the high-temperature glass is these white regions, and the black regions are igneous rock. So volcanoes erupt, the lava goes down to the beach, and as it solidifies, it also creates this glass from the sand. Here is another network covalent solid. Your instinct is to believe that zinc sulfide is an ionic compound. However, it's not. It has a three-dimensional structure that is full of this repeat pattern. Zinc sulfide is found in different rock formations, and it's a good semiconductor. This is along with gallium arsenide or indium phosphide, which have similar structures. I want to visit the periodic table briefly to talk about these combinations. I want you to see that gallium is in group 3 and arsenic is in group 5. So this combination of a group 3 and a group 5 network covalent compound makes a semiconductor. The same is true of indium and phosphorus. Indium phosphide is a network covalent semiconductor. Another example of a network covalent solid is aluminosilicates or zeolites. These are formed from aluminium and oxygen or silicon and oxygen units. Please don't worry about making sense of the stoichiometry here. There are hydrogens on the ends and sometimes oxide sites, which brings us to one of the uses for these materials. One can take hard water, which has much calcium and magnesium ion in it, and exchange it for sodium ion to make soft water. Another use of these materials is catalysts, because they have a lot of oxygen sites that are partially negative or fully negative. A final way these are useful is as molecular sieves for water purification. Here is a benzene molecule next to the cavern-like structure of the zeolite. So you can see that organic molecules can sort of wander into these structures, and just like if you went into a cave without any rope or chalk markings, you might find it hard to find your way out. That is what happens with small organic molecules with these molecular sieves. Another type of network covalent solid very popular in North Carolina is the clays with which we make pottery. These are composed of aluminium and oxygen and silicon and oxygen units, and some of them will have hydrogen bonds as well at the end. North Carolina has much beautiful pottery created by artists, and I hope that next time you look at some pottery, you appreciate what it's made of. Here is our list of network covalent solids: silicon dioxide, carbon in its many different forms, zinc sulfide, silicon, germanium, and then some 3-5 combinations that are semiconductors. How can you tell? Well, mostly you just have to memorize, but keep in mind many of these materials are near the metalloids on the periodic table. Here are our metalloids, and you notice silicon is here. Zinc sulfide is on opposite sides of the line defining the metalloid, and then some of our other ones like gallium arsenide, indium phosphide, they're definitely near the metalloids on the periodic table. The last type of solid I want to remind you of is molecular solids, which are composed of nonmetals. Earlier lectures were devoted to discussing dispersion forces, dipole forces, and hydrogen bonding. These would be some examples of molecular solids. So in our next lecture in this series, we'll be identifying different types of solids and trying to predict relative boiling and melting point.